Dear friends, welcome back. This is episode number 33. I said that I will cite some of the decisions which are relevant and some of the points also, ingredients also, which you may note under section 73, rateable distribution. What is the object of section 73? The commentary is saying to provide a cheap and expeditious remedy for the execution of money. Let us take it less expensive instead of the word cheap. The object is to provide a less expensive and expeditious remedy for the execution of money decree held against the same judgmentor by adjusting the claims of rival decree holders without the necessity for separate proceedings. This is in short the purpose of section 73. The object is twofold. This also I have taken down from the commentaries. To prevent unnecessary multiplicity of execution proceedings, to avoid each decree holder separately attaching and bringing to sale the property of the JD, to secure an equitable administration of the property by placing all the decree holders in the same position and making the property rateably divisible among them, avoids exclusion of all other decree holders by one of them merely because he happened to be the first who had attached and sold the property. So sometimes in the process where there are 100 decrees, money decrees against the same person, these are all not impossible. There are several such suits against financial institutions, against persons who have committed fraud and duped money from various persons. So, to secure an equitable administration of the property by placing all the decree holders in the same position, even if they are not entitled to get the whole amount realized, to the extent possible, all of them must be paid money. Not that when one clever person who goes to the court and first and attaches the property and sells the property and he realizes his entire amount. And what will happen to other decree holders? If they have not attached to the property, they will be in trouble. Even if after attachment there will be no problem, one attaching decree holder will not have any interest in the property. Only thing is that the judgmentor will be debarred from selling that private alienation. That does not affect the court auction sale. So once the court auction sale takes place, all other decree holders will be in trouble. So this is a method by which, a less expensive method by which justice is provided to all similarly situated persons, though there is difference in the amount covered by the decrees. Conditions. 1. The decree holder claiming to share in the rateable distribution should have applied for execution of his decree in the appropriate court, which is the appropriate court, the court which passed the decree. Court having jurisdiction. Such application should have been made prior to the receipts of assets by the court. 3. The assets of which a rateable distribution is claimed must be assets held by court. Assets held by court. 4. the attaching creditor as well as the decree holder claiming to participate in the asset should be holders of decree for payment of money. All must be holders of decree for payment of money. Such decrees should have been obtained against the same judgment debtor. So several decree holders, one judgment debtor, same judgment debtor, all decrees for payment of money. And all must have applied, those who want to claim rateable distribution must have applied to the court for execution of their respective decrees in the appropriate court. And assets are held by the court. All are decrees for payment of money. No rateable distribution can be claimed under this section unless all the conditions are fulfilled. So these conditions, there is a decision of Kerala High Court also on that point. What are the conditions? Bobban versus Sajit Kumar, 2003, Volume 3 KLT, short note, case number 176, page number 137. Essential ingredients to attract. Now another decision, two decisions, Shaji versus Dineshan, 1998, 2 KLT, 917. And State of Kerala versus Jose and others, 2000, Volume 2 KLT, 293. What was held in these decisions? A person who has merely obtained an attachment before judgment cannot put up a claim for rateable distribution unless he has obtained a decree and also made an application for execution. That he filed a suit and got an attachment before judgment under Order 38 is not a ground for participating in the rateable distribution. Rateable distribution is to realize the decree amount. So the condition precedent is that the person who applies must have obtained a decree against the same person, and that decrees for payment of money. And the other condition is that he must have applied before receipt of assets by the court. So simply because a person has obtained an attachment before judgment, that will not enable him to claim rateable distribution. Now, please note some of the decisions. 1961 KLT 531, 1961 KLT 531. Then, to which court the application should be made? There, under the 1882 code, 1882 CPC, CPC was there even before 1908. We are having the present CPC 1908. Even before that, CPC was there. It was not like sections and orders and rules. Continuous sections, just like IPC and CRPC, was there. So 235 of the 1882 code, under that code, the decree holders applying for rateable distribution should have applied for execution of their decrees to the court by which the assets are held. So say for example, different courts passed decrees. In one decree, the property is brought to sale. Asset is held by that court. All these persons must have applied for rateable distribution to that court. Now it is not necessary. Under the present code, it is sufficient that the application has been made to the appropriate court. That is because under section 63, where property has been attached in execution of decrees of several courts, the receipt of assets by the court constitutes receipt of assets by the other courts. Let us see section 63. That is the reason. Property attached in execution of decrees of several courts. The court which shall receive or realize such property shall determine any claim thereto and any objection to the attachment thereof shall be the court of highest grade, or where there is no difference in the grade between such courts, the court under whose decree the property was first attached. Proceeding taken in a court does not include an order allowing to the decree holder who has purchased property at a sale a set off, etc. So, several courts, there are proceedings. And which is the court which has to receive or realize such property and determine any claim and decide all these proceedings is the court of the highest grade. Or there is no difference in grade. It is the court which passed, first attached, where the property was first attached. So that court can. Now two decisions. Very carefully, the law students need not, because they need not go to that much complications. 1961 KLT 767, single bench, and 1961 KLT 974. The question was, a judgment debtor deposited the amount for setting aside the sale under Rule 89. Some case. And that is the judgment debtor against whom several of these decrees have been passed. Whether it can be attached for the purpose of rateable distribution was the question. Decree holder in execution of attached another decree and sold the properties. No, I am sorry, that is not the decree holder in execution attached another decree and sold the properties. Sale set aside on deposit. That is it, not ordinary decree. A decree was, execution was had by attachment of another decree. And the properties were sold. Sale was set aside on deposit. Another decree holder claimed that the money in deposit is liable for rateable distribution. And the decree holder claimed that it is his money. It was held that it is available for rateable distribution. But that 61 KLT 974 division bench holds that section 73 is subject to order 21 rule 89. Money deposited under 89 is not liable to be rateably distributed. Deposit under rule 89 operates to extinguish the decree. Attachment does not subsist thereafter. and 1961 KLT 974, the other decision is not refuted. So I leave it at that to the lawyers, what should be done. There is an apparent conflict. Then 1990 Volume 2 KLT Short Note 5, Case Number 7, 1953 KLT 576, AER 1985 Supreme Court 407. That is the state's priority. 73, you have seen nothing in this section affects any right of the government. And if a decree holder brings the JD's property to sale, and the sale proceeds are lying in deposit of the court, it was held that the state may, even without prior attachment, exercise its right to priority by making an application to the executing court for payment. If the state does not choose to apply, then the amount lying in deposit in the court, of the amount lying in deposit, but allows the amount to be taken away by some other attaching decree holder, the state cannot thereafter make the application. This is what is held. Then, AER 1987 Supreme Court, 738. It was held that when an order is passed for rateable distribution, the rights of parties become crystallized. Then it is only a ministerial act to give effect to that order. If the state lays its claim after the order for distribution is made by the court, it will be of no avail, as the property would have gone beyond the reach of the state, it having ceased to be the property of the debtor against whom the state has a claim. No question of priority can arise in that situation. So if the state wants to exercise its priority, it must be done within time. If an order is passed by the court for rateable distribution as to how it should be distributed, then what remains is the ministerial act by the court officers of the court to distribute it. Once the order is passed for rateable distribution, now the state cannot make any preferential claim. These are some of the decisions on the question of rateable distribution. Now, what else we will see now in this episode? I thought that we can deal with section 115. 115 is revision. Let us see. 115. There is an amendment of section 115 by the 1999 Amendment Act. I think you are aware that the CPC was amended, major amendment in 1976. Then another major amendment was proposed in 1999. Bill was introduced. bill was opened for discussion. It was not passed, it was not brought up. It was released for giving opinion from various quarters. All throughout India, there were discussions by the bar associations and bar councils. I remember in Kerala, the Bar Council of Kerala invited all the bar associations in the state and had 3 days discussion. Very fruitful discussion. Very many senior lawyers and other lawyers and representatives of the bar associations participated. It was a fruitful academic discussion. The minutes were recorded and it was sent to the central government. And likewise, in various quarters, there was objection. Tamil Nadu, there was, as usual, protest. Had taken different courses. And then after taking into account these objections raised from various quarters, another amendment act bill was introduced, 2002. One is Amendment Act 1999 and the other is Amendment Act 2002. Both these acts came into force on 1/7/2002. The constitutional validity of the Amendment Acts Act 2002 was challenged before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court decided it at two stages, two decisions reported. We can conveniently call it Salem 1 and Salem 2. Salem 1, the decision is reported in 2003-1. SEC 49 and Salem 2 2005-6 SEC 344. It was held by the Supreme Court that it is constitutionally valid. In Salem 1, the Supreme Court had appointed a committee headed by a retired Supreme Court judge, Justice Jagannath Rao, and by two senior advocates, Mr. Kapil Sibal and Mr. Arun Jaitley, and then Amicus Curie, Vaidyanathan, then Mr. Subrao, who was the chairman of the Bar Council of India. All these top people, they submitted reports to the court. Those reports were also taken note of by the court, and Salem 2 was passed. It was held that it is constitutionally valid. Why I refer to is that, while dealing with Section 115, you have to see Salem 2, paragraph 40. Salem 2, paragraph 40. In Salem 1 also, there is discussion about it. Please check out. Salem 1 also, I think there is discussion. Let me see. Now, see paragraph 40. What is the power of the power is there for revision only for the High Court? What is this power? Power of revision. Let us read 115. Each word is important. The High Court may call for the record of any case which has been decided by any court subordinate to such High Court and in which no appeal lies thereto. or if such subordinate court appears to have three clauses, to have exercised a jurisdiction not vested in it by law, or to have failed to exercise a jurisdiction so vested, or to have acted in the exercise of its jurisdiction illegally or with material irregularity. So the High Court has exclusive jurisdiction to deal with the revision under 115 civil revision petition. It may call for the record of any case which has been decided by any court subordinate to it and from which no appeal lies. If an appeal lies, the High Court will not interfere in revision. And if such subordinate court appears to have committed any of the three ingredients, to have exercised a jurisdiction not vested in it by law, or failed to exercise a jurisdiction vested in it by law, or acted in the exercise of its jurisdiction with illegality or material irregularity. These are the any of the three ingredients is satisfied. The High Court may entertain the revision and pass such orders. The difficulty comes thereafter. Provided that the High Court shall not, under this section, vary or reverse any order made or any order deciding an issue in the course of a suit or other proceeding, except where the order, if it had been made in favor of the party applying for revision, would have finally disposed of the suit or other proceeding. It is to some extent complicated. We'll approach it in a very simple manner. The court has power to interfere in revision. 115. If any of the three circumstances arises, acted without jurisdiction, did not exercise the jurisdiction vested in it by law, failed, or acted with material irregularity or illegality, any of these conditions, the power can be exercised. But while exercising the power, the court will not vary or reverse any order except when, if the order had been the other way about, it would have disposed of the suit or other proceeding. So the litmus test is, now the order is this way, the order is against a dismissal of an application. Suppose the application is allowed, whether it would have disposed of the suit or other proceeding, then only the High Court will interfere in revision. Suppose the application is allowed, order is challenged. Had the application been dismissed, it would have the effect of disposal of the suit or other proceeding, then the High Court will interfere in revision if there is any of these three categories coming in. A, B, C. Not always. When any of these circumstances exist, then the court can interfere. But this is a rider. In spite of the presence of any of those three categories of situations, the High Court will not interfere in revision, except where, will not vary or reverse any order made, not interfere, vary or reverse any order made, unless the order, if it had been the other way about, it would have disposed of the suit or other proceeding. This proviso was substituted in CPC Amendment Act 40, 6 of 99. What was the position before this? The three ABC clauses same. And this proviso also to some extent same. Provided that the High Court shall not under this section vary or reverse any order made or any order deciding an issue in the course of a suit or other proceeding, except where. Till then, it was the same. Then there were two clauses, A and B. A was the order, if it had been made in favor of the party applying for revision, would have finally disposed of the suit or other proceeding. Same thing. Then there was a clause B. The order, if allowed to stand, would occasion a failure of justice or cause irreparable injury to the party against whom it was made. So in spite of the fact that clause A, which is now in existence after substitution, is absent, clause B was to the help of the litigants where there is a gross injustice, in spite of the fact that the order, the other way about, it would not have disposed of the suit or other proceeding, still there is injustice. Then the court, the order, if allowed to stand, would occasion a failure of justice or cause irreparable injury to the party against whom such order was made. So on this ground, very many revisions were being entertained. It is not on the ground that the order, if it is the other way about, I would have succeeded. The whole proceeding would have been over. Such satisfaction, that circumstance may not be satisfied. That will be satisfied in only rare cases. There is no difficulty in applying ABC. Only if this that applies, any of the ingredient applies, revisional power can be exercised. But this clause B came to the rescue of very many litigants. And if there is a glaring illegality, an injustice done to a party, then the court could interfere. But that clause B was taken away and it was substituted. That is the present form. We will deal with the rest of it in the next episode. Thank you.